Have you ever been in an argument and filter's not working anymore and you say something that you regret? Anybody? Okay, maybe less of you are like me because I do it a lot. Early in my marriage, I did it too often. And I said odd things, weird things. Things like there was a time when my wife and I were having an argument and it was late at night. I just, you know, wanted to go to sleep. We were in bed, lights are out, and we're not even looking at each other. We're just staring at the ceiling having an argument. And I was tired and I was done, and I didn't want to fight anymore. So I say to my wife, right now, your voice is like physical pain to my body, and I just want it to stop. Yeah. It was awesome. It was awesome. That went well. I was doing this a lot early in our marriage and noticed that I kept saying things in the heat of a moment and having to go back later and say, sorry, I didn't mean that. And so there was a time when we were in an argument and I left the room kind of angry and mad and thought about it and then felt really upset about something. So I came back into the room and I said to my wife, when I come to you in about an hour and say I'm sorry and I didn't mean what I said, don't believe me. I mean what I'm saying right now. Shot myself in the foot. I don't even know what I was thinking. I was young and young. There's another time. This is my favorite. This is my favorite one. All these are like right in the first couple years of our marriage. And we had Madison, our oldest. She was young and she was a toddler, and we're teaching her manners at this point. And so Lindsay and I are having an argument, and I clearly, like all of them, had lost it. Like I was the one in the wrong, right? I mean, it was just, I was wrong. I recognized this in the middle of the fight, but didn't want to give her the satisfaction of the win. So at the right time, I just decided to leave the room. And I make it into another room that just so happened to have a TV in it, and the TV was on. And so I sit down, and Lindsay comes in, and remember, we're teaching Madison manners, and so I just calmly turn to my wife, and I say, Lindsay, right now you're being rude. Right now it's the TV's turn to talk, and when it's done talking, it'll be your turn to talk. Yeah. Funny now. Not so funny then. Only by God's grace, Lindsay and I are still married. Next month, we'll be celebrating 15 years of marriage, and so we're really excited about God doing that. Now, I've had a lot of those moments. If you have two, share them with me, and I'll use them in a sermon in the future, because they're always funny. Later. With my wife, Lindsay, I have learned this. In fact, I knew this even before. I knew this with my parents, that it was really easy for me to work my way in and out of a good relationship with people, right? When you tell somebody that their voice is like physical pain in your body, it just, you're working your way out of a good relationship with them. I also knew this to be really, really true with my parents, that I could, there's some things I could do to make my parents happy and make life easier, and there's some things that I could do that would really tick them off, and I also knew when to ask for money and when not to ask for money based on the things I'd been doing, you know. Some of you students in the room may know what I'm talking about. You still work that system, right? Some of you parents have picked up on your kids doing that to you, you know. So for me, it's real easy, right? Work your way in and out of a relationship with people. And the problem that I've made in my life is I've lived all my life knowing that, and most of my life feeling like that in my relationship with God. I feel like for years I've lived under this feeling that I can work my way into a better relationship with Him, and I can also work my way out of a good relationship with my Heavenly Father. The way we relate with others kind of influences the way we think we relate with God. You know, we believe in salvation by grace, right? I mean, I grew up in the church, and I have shared with a lot of different people, it is solely by grace that you can come to Christ. It's by your faith and what He has done. It has nothing to do with what you do. It's what He's done. And I share it over and over, but still, for some reason, I had in my head this mentality that after Christ, I personally still had works and deeds and things I needed to do to be in a right relationship with God. I've lived so much of my life, my faith, with a works-based mentality. We tend to do this in a couple of ways. One of the ways we live based on works is we feel like our sins separate God. We feel like our sins make God angry, and so he needs some space and some time to cool off after we mess up. Right? I mean, if you start thinking about it, I've done this so often in my life where I almost kind of start to rank sins in my head, like, well, that wasn't so bad, so I can still go to God. But then after some of the biggies, you know, the big ones, I'm like, oof, God needs a breather. Like God has mood swings or something, you know, like, I'm going to give him some time, let him cool off. If he's anything like... Okay. See, you know, you start to get a filter someday. Praise the Lord. Spirit works. So I've wrestled with feeling like God needs space after I mess up. That he's angry, he's upset. That he views me in a different light. The other way that we struggle with this is when it comes to our acts of righteousness. The good things that we do to honor God, right? Sometimes we think our sin separates from him, but the flip side of it is we think the good things we do somehow make us better in God's eyes and in his heart. You know, for me, I remember when I was younger, I went on a missions trip. At the tail end of the missions trip, I was like, psh, God must be pretty impressed with me because I'm awesome. I kind of boldly come into the presence of God now, like, sup, God? Pretty awesome, right? You must be so proud. I'm better than the rest of these people, right? We start comparing ourselves to others, right? And we kind of even start to do these things where we even feel like, okay, if I do something that's sacrificial, that's really hard, well, then God's going to be extra impressed. Maybe some of you in the room just hate kids. And so you're like, well, I'm going to serve in kids ministry then. They need summer servants? Sign me up. I'm jumping in. I don't care that they're a bunch of droolers and nasty. I'm going to do it because God's going to be impressed because he knows I hate them. Maybe we write a bigger check. Maybe we do some things just because it's hard for us and hopes that because it's even difficult for us, somehow God's going to be like, oh, wow, you're so much better than the other Christians. Look at you trying so hard. I'm so proud of you. Like, is that really how God works? Like, our deeds change how he sees us? Like, our sins change how he sees us? The problem is when we start living that way, this works-based mentality in our relationship with Christ as Christ followers, what we've done is we've underestimated the grace of God. We've completely underestimated how great his grace is. And what we do is we overestimate our sins, and we overestimate our acts of righteousness. In the context of God and his grace, we've messed it all up. And we think our sins are a bigger deal than they are. We think our acts of righteousness are too. You know, if you struggle with that, like I have for a lot of my faith and a lot of my journey, you're not alone. You're not the first ones to struggle with it. The Galatian church struggled with this a lot. That's why Paul wrote them this letter. They were a group of people who just, they heard about Christ. They knew what Christ had done for them. They're putting their faith in that and believing that it's just all around his grace and it's all about what he's done. But then all of a sudden this works-based mentality began to creep in into the church. There were some people who were devout Jews who converted to Christianity, but then had kind of made their way into the Galatian church and started kind of spreading some lies. They started saying things like, hey, listen, if you want to follow Christ, that's great. You got to get circumcised too, and you have to do this and this and this and this. And they kind of came in and tried to bring in the tradition of the Jewish faith into this, into the new Christian faith. And so all of a sudden, this Galatian church starts struggling with a works-based mentality when it came to their faith and their walk with Christ. So Paul writes them this letter. It says, hey, you've lost it. You've lost the way. Let me set you straight. Let me help you understand. So we're going to go through here. You can follow along. The verses will be up on the screen, or you can open up your Bibles to Galatians chapter 5, verse 1. Now, Paul makes an incredible argument throughout this whole letter, talking about how to live in and through the Spirit and how not to allow works to creep in. And we're going to pop in and what he has to say here in chapter 5. Follow along with me. It is for slavery that Christ has set us free. Is that what it says? It is for works that Christ has set us free. It is for circumcision that Christ has set us free. No, what is it for? It is for what?
Freedom
that Christ has set us free. Paul's telling him, hey, listen, Christ didn't set you free to live this difficult life. Christ didn't set you free so you can live in freedom and slavery, or in bondage and slavery. Christ set you free so you can live in the fullness of the freedom. He continues and he says this, stand firm then and do not let yourselves be burdened again by the yoke of slavery. Don't take it on. Don't take on that works-based mentality, that trying to measure up, that trying to be good enough. That is bondage that you do not have to live in. It is for freedom that you've been set free. Here's what Paul continues to say, verse 2. He says, mark my words. I, Paul, tell you that if you let yourselves be circumcised, Christ will be of no value to you at all. This is a powerful statement. Paul said, hey, mark my words, pay attention. If you follow through with this, if you get circumcised, if you do this works thing, here's what's happening. You've missed it. You've missed the cross. You've missed the bloodshed. You've missed the grace. You don't get it. And he continues and says, I again declare to every man who lets himself be circumcised that he is obligated to obey the whole law. What Paul is saying, he's saying, hey, and if you're new to church, you're not sure what the law is a whole list of hundreds of rules and laws that God gave Moses to his followers generations before. And they believed that if they followed all these laws, they would be right with God. But earlier in this letter, Paul says to the Galatians, hey, just a reminder, the law was never given to save. It was to show you that you need a savior. That's what the law was for. That was the purpose of it. And so Paul's telling them, hey, you know what? If you want to get circumcised, just go ahead and just do the whole law thing. If you're going to follow one, try and follow them all. Because what you'll see is that you'll never, ever measure up. The law works will never save you. It'll just show you that you need a savior. So Paul says, okay, if you want to do that, go for it. But take on the whole list. Take it all on. And then he says this, you who are trying to be justified by the law have been alienated from Christ. You have fallen away from grace. He challenges this church and says, oh, you foolish Galatians. Remember, I shared it with you. You got it. You understood. It is just Christ. It's Jesus plus nothing. That's it. There's no works, no deeds, no trying. It's like, and you've fallen away from grace. You've lost the message somewhere. And here you are, again, trying. You're trying again. Why do you think God sees you like that? Why do you think God's going to be impressed? Why do you think God's going to be angry? It's not what it's about. If you're here last week, when we looked at Ephesians, we saw that this is how God sees us. We have Christ in us. There's a series of boxes here. Way back in there, you can see a little box. You can faintly see Christ written right there. That's Christ, and he's in you. There's a you box there representing you. So you have Christ in you. and you are in Christ. And because Christ is in the Father, we are therefore in the Father. And this is who you are in Christ. And so when God looks at you, he mainly sees himself. You have been reconciled to God. Maybe you haven't heard this before, maybe you didn't understand it fully, but you, when you put your faith in Christ, you become the righteousness of God. He who knew no sin became sin on our behalf so that we might become the righteousness of him. This is us in Christ, and this is how God sees us. And you did not behave your way into a relationship with him, and you cannot misbehave your way out of it. You didn't behave your way into the righteousness of God, and you cannot misbehave your way out of it. Right now, standing on this stage, I am the righteousness of God, and I have not earned it. I have not done anything good enough to be the righteousness of him, but he has declared me his righteousness, holy. And in him, I can find my hope. I can find peace, and I can find rest in the one that loves me. It is for freedom that I've been set free. I no longer have to take on the yoke of slavery of trying to be good enough. So, if you live your life and in this faith, trying to do good things for God so that he'll be impressed, you don't have to do that anymore. In this chapter, he talks about that we should just have a faith that is expressed in love, and that's how we are to live. Just live a life of love. Should we serve in the church? Yeah. Does it have to be with kids if you hate kids? No, gosh, no. But serve in the church the way God has wired you, and don't do it because God will be impressed. Do it because Scripture teaches that's when you're going to grow the most. Can we go on and sin? You can. You can sin every day for the rest of your life, and it will not change how God sees you. You are the righteousness of him. And I know you're waiting for a but. There's not a but. You can go on and sin every day, and that will not change the way God sees you. And he has offered you freedom from the sin, though. He's offered you a new life. Please, this week, read the rest of Galatians and look what it says about how you live a life surrendered and Christ in you moves and works and you live out the fruits of the Spirit and you just change. And again, it's not about trying. It's about surrender. I heard about this family that did an international adoption, and it was a family out of Atlanta, and they adopted a girl from China, and they adopted her, and she was a toddler, and they got her home. And they, you know, it was a whole long ordeal and a long process, but they get her home, and one of the things that they notice is every time after breakfast is over, she grabs a handful of Cheerios and hangs on to them for the rest of the day. So all day she's playing with Cheerios in one hand and one hand free just to play with her toys. At the end of the night, she's in bed and they pry her hand open and they pull out soggy Cheerios. She did it day after day. Breakfast is over and she grabs a handful of Cheerios and hangs on to them. The family that adopted her, they were talking with the agency that they were working with, and they have counselors and the whole thing, and they kind of started to find out that this happens a lot where kids go from what they had to do in their old life, and they still kind of carry on some of those habits into their new life. And for this little girl, she was in the orphanage and didn't always know when the next meal would always come and if there would be enough for her or not. So whenever there was extra, she would grab it and hang on to it just in case she was going to be hungry again. The parents are looking at their little girl now. She's in the land of abundance, and she's still living an old life, an old system. And I think God looks at us and he sees that we have a new life to live, but we are hanging on to the old way, clinging on to it, feeling the weight of it. And it's wearing us out. And we're exhausted and tired. And yet we still hold it. It's for freedom. It's for freedom that you've been set free. And Christ is just waiting for us to let go. He's waiting for us just to trust and say, okay, I'm done. I'm done living an old life. I'm done hanging on. I'm done with guilt and shame and trying to measure up. I just want you to take a moment and pause and imagine, what will your walk with Christ look like if you completely let go of the works mentality? What will it look like for you just to let it go and live in the freedom that Christ has set you free to live in? Sin no longer has any power over you, and you can live in victory. Sin does not change the way God sees you. And your acts of righteousness don't change them. Just live in the freedom that God sees you, perfect, holy, free from accusation. And allow the Spirit to work through you, and you live out of faith and love and see how your life does change. God, in you, we find hope. God, in you we find peace. In you and you alone we find rest. God, I know so many of us struggle with a works mentality. God, I just ask that you just help us just to break free from that. Help us not to be like the Galatian church. But God, let us live in the fullness of you. May we no longer underestimate your grace. May we see the fullness of it. May we see what you've saved us for, what you've saved us from, and what you've saved us to.